we are go for launch.
Five.
Quiet, numbskulls. I'm broadcasting.
Anything can happen in the next half hour.
Four.
My friend, we cannot keep this a secret any longer.
This whole thing is insane.
Three.
Quiet, please. I am analyzing.
Where's the kaboom?
Two.
There was supposed to be an earth-shattering kaboom.
One.
You have something I want. You may think you have some idea of what you are in possession of, but you do not.
Moff Gideon, you have something I want. You may think you have some idea what you are in possession of, but you do not. Soon, he will be back with me. He means more to me than you will ever know.
Greetings, my fellow galactic travelers, and welcome back to Planet 8. This is your mission commander, Larry, speaking to you from our hidden base. Chief Engineer Bob is here by my side as always in the command center, and circling Planet 8 in our orbital spy satellite is Reconnaissance Officer Karen.
And on this episode of Planet 8, 'tis the season to be jolly and also celebrate the season finale of Season 2 of The Mandalorian. I'm going to let you guys know there's going to be a lot of spoilers. So if you have not seen Season 2 of The Mandalorian, especially the last episode of this season, come back after you watch it, because here we go up to the satellite, Karen. Take it away.
And there may be some tears in this episode, too. You never know.
Big manly tears shed in this episode. Well, man, what a season. You know, we enjoyed the first season so much. It was, I think we could all probably agree, the best Star Wars since the original Star Wars.
Right.
And, you know, I don't feel disappointed in this season. I enjoyed it quite a bit. You know, they just continue, Favreau and Filoni continue to, it's like they managed to bring the best of the old in and bring it back in new ways that is so exciting and so refreshing. And that's what I really enjoyed about this season. You know, we had a lot of characters show up, many from the animated shows like Ahsoka and Bo-Katan. But then we got like Boba Fett, and I had to like eat all my words, because I used to say, you know, Boba Fett never did, you know, bleep. He was never nothing, didn't do anything. And then they bring him in and make him this really interesting character. You know, they brought him back and did some cool stuff with him. But then, you know, through the course of the show, you know, they also really did some character growth with our pal Mando, Din Djarin, and Grogu. You know, the baby got a name, Grogu.
Right.
And continued to build on that. And you know, as we discussed the episodes, we also got some what I thought were sort of kind of adult moments in Star Wars, where we kind of pulled back the curtain on what really happened in the war between the Empire and the Rebels, and you know how hard what the toll was of that war on people. So yeah, it was just a spectacular year. And that season finale, I know we're going to talk about it, but you know, I'm a huge Luke Skywalker fan, so it just blew my mind. what about you guys?
Who? What? Luke was in it? Hey, at least it wasn't a blink and you miss it moment.
That's what I thought it was going to be. I thought it was going to be a hint. So, yeah, it was exciting.
No, the thing that amazed me about this season, even more than season one, every episode looked like a movie. I mean, the sets, and, you know, I know a lot of it is green screen background type stuff, but just the sets and the planets and the characters and the way it was shot. And it was just amazing. And it was like, you know, you're watching a half hour motion picture each week. And I think what probably happened was, after the first season was a big hit, Disney just handed the checkbook to Favreau and said, here, do whatever you got to do, because it was a great season. And, you know, we got to wait, what is it, a year now until the next season?
Yeah, December.
So hopefully, you know, hopefully it's going to be the same. It's going to be worth the wait. And it's going to be, you know, if it takes an exponential jump between season 2 to 3, as it did in season 1 to 2, then it could be, we could be looking at something pretty amazing next year.
Oh, absolutely. And I'm wondering if, you know, maybe Mando or Bo-Katan or whoever might show up in the Ahsoka show that they're talking about, or in some of the other, you know, what is it, the Wild Bunch or whatever, the animated.
The Bad Batch.
The Bad Batch. There's all this content that Disney's releasing.
Right.
Who knows who might make an appearance where?
Right. They're making a interconnected universe now with all these different shows.
Right, right. And what Bob was saying about the just it looking so epic and cinematic, even story-wise, one of the things Jazz and I were going over, because she hadn't seen the Clone Wars, the animated series. She, you know, was asking, well, who's Bo-Katan? And, you know, let alone Rebels, you know, I had to explain who Ahsoka Tano was. So we're going back and watching that. And I watched the final season, the final episode of Clone Wars, spoiler alert, where Ahsoka lays the helmets down for the fallen clone troopers and drops the saber. And it was so cinematic when Vader shows up and he knows Ahsoka did this, and looks down and picks up the saber. I mean, yes, it's an animated show, but it had such gravitas. And David Filoni working with Jon Favreau, I mean, he brought that to Mandalorian time and time again. It is just such a beautiful story. One of the things I like too is, you know, last year was season 1, this was season 2. Yeah, they call it season 2, but it's chapter 10, chapter 11. It carries on that tradition of the Star Wars films.
Yeah, it was also the way they integrated those characters from the animated series. It didn't feel forced.
Right.
You know, it felt like it made sense. Characters like Bo-Katan, even Ahsoka, you know, it's like you could say, well, people like to complain and say, oh, it's fan service. It's fan service. Well, number one, don't you want to see those characters? And two, okay, he's looking for a Jedi. You know, there's not a lot of Jedi left, so he meets Ahsoka. It makes sense to me. Or Bo-Katan. He's looking for Mandalorians. He runs into her. I mean, the way they handled them, it all seemed to make sense, and it was done so well. The characters were already there. You understood them. And I could see how, like, somebody like Jasmine, not having seen the shows, they're integrated in such a way that you don't necessarily have to have watched all the shows before to get, you know, why they're there and what their background or their history is.
Well, that's true. I figure I've got a year now to watch all those shows, because I haven't watched them either. You know, I'm pretty much a Star Wars movie guy. So, I mean, Michael or Debbie would have to, like, explain to me, like, who some of these characters were. When they'd get all excited, they'd come on screen. It's like, what? Who's that? Yeah.
Right. I mean, Jazz appreciates the fall of Mandalore. Okay. Well, how would you like to see how the fall of Mandalore came about? We'll watch, you know, the third season of the Clone Wars and part of the fifth season, or, you know, whatever. It's just a fun experience. It's a great time to be a fan, you know?
And isn't it funny that kind of the future of Star Wars looks to be on television? I would never have thought that in a million years.
Well, they are working on more movies, but yeah, I mean, so far Mandalorian, like we've said before, it's the best Star Wars since the original trilogy. So
yeah,
you know, maybe they're making more movies, but hopefully the movies are going in the same direction as Mandalorian and some of the other TV shows hopefully will be going in.
You know, one of the things I was wondering, Bob, was will we ever see another trilogy, or will it be Rogue One or a Han Solo story where we just get, like, one shots?
Well, I'm thinking that they will probably have Jon Favreau be the Kevin Feige of Star Wars.
Yeah, I agree with you on that. Because
you need
you need
one singular vision, and it used to be George Lucas. Uh-huh. And between Lucas and Favreau, there were just like half a dozen different visions, and each movie had a different director, and they'd each go in different directions, and then one director would have to bring it back, you know, into the right path or whatever. And I think that's where they went astray. And it's almost like DC with their movies for a while there. They had no singular vision. Hey, no, really, they had no singular vision. So they were kind of, you know, each one's, it wasn't like a cohesive universe. It's like each one had a different style, a different vision, a different outlook, different actors for some of the characters. So, yeah, to have a singular linear, you know, anchor point for all these different, because, you know, if you're going to have movies and TV shows, and I mean, even Marvel, I'll criticize Marvel. Their TV shows were not connected to the movies. So again, you had like a couple of different directions, whereas they could have easily integrated all of it together, especially like Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. And had a singular vision. You know, they did great with the movies, you know, and they had some good TV shows, but they had nothing to do with the movies. But
yeah, Marvel, I think, saw the light. They start, you know, with the Netflix shows. There was a reference to, you know, the Battle of New York, and same with S.H.I.E.L.D. I think Sif showed up at one point, but
the last season or second to last season of S.H.I.E.L.D. they were talking about the Battle of New York and, you know, all that, and it was pretty intertwined, but it was like the movies didn't acknowledge the TV shows. The TV shows would reference the movies, and I guess I heard that they're bringing the Netflix Daredevil into Spider-Man 3 now. So,
you know, there's so much going on about Spider-Man 3.
Spider-Man 3 is just going to be a big soup. Like when you make a stew with a bunch of leftovers. And
yeah.
It comes out good, though, sometimes.
Yeah.
You start seeing things like Mark Hamill is going to reprise his role as Luke Skywalker in Spider-Man 3. So, yeah,
exactly.
Yeah, it's gotten pretty ridiculous.
He probably would, though.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Because, at the end during the credits, it's like, you know, it said Mark Hamill. And Debbie's like, oh, he did the voice. I go, of course he did the voice. He does voices all over cartoons. So he's got no problem doing that. He's not like, I'm a motion picture actor. I'm above this. Well, you know?
I was a little surprised. Did you guys watch the Star Wars holiday special, the Lego?
Yes, I did.
Show?
No, he not the Lego.
He didn't do the voice in that.
Really?
And in Twitter, he said he wasn't asked.
Oh, my goodness. Well, that's so
interesting. If they asked him, I'm sure he would have.
Too
expensive,
know.
Maybe? I don't know.
Missed opportunity.
Yeah. It was a cute special.
I was going to say, it was, actually. It was, you know, cute, funny.
I'll have to go back and look at it. I'm like building my way up to watching rewatching the Sabrina holiday special along with the Creepshow holiday special. So I'll have to throw in the Lego Star Wars holiday special.
You'll have fun with both, actually, Bob.
Jeepers, I got to get like Charlie Brown and Rudolph in if I'm going to have a traditional Christmas here. So
Charlie Brown, check. Rudolph, check. what else did we watch? There was one other. Oh, Santa Claus is Coming to Town.
But, well, I'll tell you what. Let's steer it back into Mando.
Well, this is our Christmas episode too, right? So.
Like you guys always tell me when I bring up Batman versus Superman.
Hey. All right. Well, we got our Batman versus Superman reference in. Well, do you want to talk a little bit about, we could go through each episode and kind of talk about each one and what we thought about it?
Yeah, sure.
Sure.
All right.
One of the things, you know, I really enjoyed straight away. I mean, the first episode, we get R5, Gamorreans, Weequay. We find out what a crate dragon looks like. I mean, I was just blown away with all the little Easter eggs that we got and Boba Fett's armor.
Yeah.
And at first I was like, wow, Boba Fett survived, but boy, he's lanky now.
He's a skinny dude now.
Yeah, was, well, yeah, they definitely crazy. Kicked off. And when I was talking about the whole motion picture thing, the creatures in this thing, like, you know, the crate dragon and the spiders and whatever. I mean, that dragon was pretty damn impressive for a TV show.
Oh, man. I mean, the banthas looked good. And all the little details, you know, we saw the Tusken Raider kind of cleaning the bantha's teeth with the other side of its gaffy stick.
Yeah.
Because you always wondered, did they just use those to beat the heck out of, you know, enemies? It had a practical use. I was just like, cool.
Well, also when they're traveling on the banthas and it's like they're traveling single file.
Yeah.
To hide their numbers or, you know, it's
like. Obi-Wan wasn't no fool. He knew what was going on.
Yeah, that's right. And the other thing I loved was the Tuscan sign language.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's like, what do you mean when you. No, with the sign language, it's like, oh, okay.
Yeah, because there's part where Mando's like speaking English, but he's doing the sign language. So,
yeah.
I love the spaghetti Western feel of this episode. And of course, they've taken the Tuscans, who had once been just this kind of very one note villain in Star Wars, and made them into, they're basically like Native Americans, you know, if you're going to do a Western analogy. And it's like, you know, the settlers are like, oh, they're barbarians, they're raiders, they're terrible. And you know, Din's like, hey, they're tough because this land is tough. You know, they're rough and tumble because they have to be. But you know what? You guys have, you know, infringed on their land. You've taken their resources, you know. So, hey, give them a shot here. Right. And I liked that they gave them another dimension. You know, they weren't just these ugly creatures that run around, you know, killing folks out in the desert. It's like, oh, so again, we take something that's old that we recognize from Star Wars, but it's like, oh, we get to see a new angle on this whole thing. And like you said, Larry, oh, they're, you know, they're in their camp, they're taking care of the banthas, and it's just like, wow, this is so cool. It's something I recognize, but I get to see it in a whole new way.
Yeah.
You know?
Who was the sheriff?
Vance. That was Timothy Oliphant.
Oh, Oliphant, okay. Yeah, I know. I was hoping he would be back, but...
Yeah, I wondered if we would see him again, but maybe another time.
Ways with you know, I hope to see you. I hope to see you too. I think he'll, you know, like I said, it's going to be such a big universe on Disney Plus. These characters are bound to show up again. I mean,
well, plus he's skipping from planet to planet and returning to planets, and you know, I'll go back here and get the ship. Well, he doesn't have to get the ship repaired anymore, but.
It's, you know, one of the things I want to say, yes, we've got it. Jon Favreau did an amazing job on this. But again, Dave Filoni, they really did a good job bringing characters that he created in the animated series in Clone Wars into The Mandalorian. And it just made such logical sense. And, you know, Filoni's famously a disciple of George Lucas. I mean, George has said...
Mm-hmm.
Dave's, you know, the guy after me, and has worked very closely with him. And, you know, it's just such a, I said it before, it's such a great time to be a fan. I mean, with these guys working this universe now, good things are going to come out of this based on what we've seen.
Well, plus, I think they're talking to George. I mean, there were some shots of George on the set.
Mm-hmm.
So he's around. He's just not credited these days.
Yeah, it was kind of funny to see a picture of him holding baby Yoda. It would be nice to know what he thinks of the Mandalorian, but I haven't seen any comments anywhere. I don't know if you guys have.
Yeah, I haven't seen him do an interview in a while, so.
Mm-hmm.
Famously silent. George, do you have any comments? No, not really.
That sounds more like Kermit.
Entertaining show.
Yeah, quite entertaining. Go ahead, Walker.
I was just going to say, I did think it was a little odd that the way Mando started off on his quest to find other Jedi was to look for other Mandalorians. I wasn't quite sure where that was going, other than maybe he just didn't know, like, who to ask.
Well, I don't think he really knew what a Jedi was, really.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You know,
and maybe he didn't trust anybody.
I think he was looking for the first Mandalorian to tell him, okay, here's where you look for Jedis, but...
Right. Maybe he knew that the Jedi and the Mandalorians have had, you know, encounters in their history. So.
Yeah, I guess we can chalk it up to that.
I'll say one of the things, too, you know, again, with the details, not since, what, 12, 15 years ago when we all learned the word frack in another famous series, did we get a colorful swear word, dink ferric. Time and time again, we see, you know, the gun's broken, dink ferric. The kid pulled the ball off of the, you know, throttle for the command or the ship. Dank ferric.
Yeah, it took me a while to figure out that that was actually a swear word.
A swear word, not a drink.
Dank ferric. I was like, what is he talking about? Is that a planet?
There you go. Beep, boop.
Well, that's the amazing thing, too, even though they, you know, obviously this is on Disney Plus, but, you know, it's on like a quote, streaming or cable network, they could swear all they want, but they don't, except for made up swear words. But you know, it's very, very kid friendly.
Yeah. Well, you know, speaking of kid friendly, there was a lot of uproar on the interwebs over the chapter 10, The Passenger, and Frogly.
Yeah, but I mean, come on, you know, it's like we know he eats frogs. And here's this big frog mama with her eggs, and it's like, you know, sure, you know, it'd be good.
I mean, very people tasty. Were sitting there saying, oh, he's committing genocide. It's like, come on, he's eating a bunch of unfertilized eggs. He's a kid. It's funny. Every time he pops it in his mouth, come on, it's funny.
Well, yeah, I mean, it was a running joke through the episode.
And when when Mandalorian realizes what he's doing, he's like, no, stop it. And you know what I mean, too. Behave yourself. I will say, and not to criticize, but of all the episodes this series, this was the one that didn't. It was good, but at first I was like, meh. It was okay. I watched it two or three more times getting ready for the podcast, and it did grow on me. There were moments like with the baby Yoda eating the tadpoles, and also the X-Wing pilots. Famously, Dave Filoni is on screen again as an X-Wing pilot. So that was fun.
Oh, I thought the ice spiders were great. Being a monster guy myself. Yeah, anytime you bring in like the crate dragon or you bring in the ice spiders, I mean, that's right up my alley.
Yeah, they had two big monsters right in a row. That was kind of interesting.
Yeah, and you know, the whole ice. I mean, everything. I think the majority of stories on Star Wars movies or TV take place on a desert planet. So it was refreshing to see something like, you know, Hoth or what is the Wookiee, Kashyyyk, you know, something other than sand. So it was cool to be on that planet for a bit. Now, why the frog lady decided to skinny dip in that heated pond, and how did she know the heated pond was there? These were the little things that kind of like bugged me, and I'm like, well, you're overthinking it, Keikos.
I think she just wandered off, and it's like, hey, look what we have here.
Hey, hot tub.
Take a dip. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's cold as hell, right?
Yeah, she wanted to get, you know, warmed up. She's a cold-blooded creature. So she had no way to warm up. She had to jump in that hot water.
What cracked me up was she took all the eggs out, and see, the eggs were all like bathing in there with her.
But I really enjoyed that one. I liked the interchange between Mando, the exchange between him and the X-Wing pilots. You know, he's trying to help. Oh, yeah, I don't have to fly with the transponder officer. And then the power dive and, you know, trying to trick them. And I thought that was really cool. And it's interesting to see the rebel pilots and, you know, okay, so now that the alliance is basically in power, what are they doing? You know, how are they trying to manage things and the Outer Rim? And that was an interesting exchange at the end, too, where they basically let him go, but they didn't really help him patch his ship up or anything. They just kind of said, okay, we're going to let you go, but you're on your own.
Yeah, figure it out.
Yeah, but once he does get it patched, sort of.
he's able. Now, at first I thought that was like the Mon Calamari homeworld, Trask, the planet Trask, but Frog Lady reunites with her hubby there, so, you know, that was a nice thing.
Well, they had Mon Calamari there, and then they had, who are the other guys? Are they Kraken, or are they... Gosh, I'm forgetting my Star Wars aliens. I'm going to have to take it.
It's a no prize to any of the listeners who can name that race.
But, yeah.
But also, it's the next episode where Grogu kind of redeems himself, because the frog couple basically babysit him.
Yeah.
And when Mando goes back to pick him up, he's like playing with the tadpole and, you know, not eating it. I think he learned his lesson.
Right. There was like this little sound where Grogu was actually surprised, like, oh, that's what that is. And, you know.
Yeah, I like when he leaves him there. He goes, mind your manners. You know what I'm talking about. But yeah, and the Razor Crest, that poor ship, it's all beat to hell. Then it totters over the side of the landing pad and sinks. And then they've got what looks like, you know, basically AT-ATs that have been refurbished as cranes. And right. They have to haul it out of the water.
Well, see, I love that part, because it was always the big theory that the AT-ATs were based on the cranes that are out on the harbor in Oakland.
To me, they came full circle in that episode. I thought that was awesome.
And like Dennis Muren has always said, no. But if you look at it, you know, you drive over the Bay Bridge from San Francisco over to Oakland, and you look over to the right and you see those things standing there. It's like, that's where they came from.
Yeah.
So to have them turned back into cranes, yeah, that was pretty cool. Full circle.
It's probably a subliminal thing that he may not say that that's where he got the idea, but it's probably deep in the recesses of his mind.
Well, I mean, you know, ILM, Lucasfilm, they're all local in the San Francisco Bay Area. So, you know, they always have to drive over that bridge, and they're probably looking at those things all the time.
Yeah, definitely. I said, it was so cool to see it like used in that fashion.
And so this is the episode where, of course, Bo-Katan shows up, Katie Sackhoff,
mm-hmm.
and her two fellow Mandalorians to save Din and the baby.
Now, she did the voice of Bo-Katan in the cartoon, right?
Yeah, she did.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
All right. So that was cool.
Oh, yeah. That was, like, very cool.
Now, I have to say, I don't know that I find her the greatest actress. Now, some people may be offended by that. I find her a little stiff in her performances. But I thought it was very interesting that this is the first time Mando is confronted with a group of Mandalorians outside of his own, I don't know what you want to call it, clan, sect, or whatever. And, he reacts pretty badly towards them.
Well, I think it, like, shocks him that, you know, after they rescue him and Grogu, that they come up and just pull their helmets off.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, he's, like, the last, I think, of the Mandalorians that, like, adheres or tried to adhere to not removing the helmet. But,
well, back in season one, when he goes down, you know, to the clubhouse, for lack of a better, the hideout, and he sees that all the Mandalorians took off their armor to escape, and just the gravitas of that action and that moment, where he's just like, huh? And she explains, you know, they did what they had to do to survive. And, you know, we'll get into this later on as we talk about Mayfield coming back in. But there was a very poignant moment where he's like, well, what is it, Mando? Is it that you don't take off your helmet or you don't show your face? Because those are two very different things.
Now, But did they take off their armor, or were they assumed to be killed? Because my impression was that maybe they had been killed and the armorer had somehow gotten a hold of their armor. So I don't know. I'm confused as to what actually happened to them.
My impression was that they took off the armor so that they could escape. Because one would be looking for them. And that's why the armor was there in the clubhouse and not with the Empire.
They're running naked in the streets somewhere.
Basically. But I could be wrong. You know, we have a year to go back and watch.
But yeah, it really, it shakes him up. I mean, and then she tells him, oh, you're part of a member of that, almost implying like he's in some sort of weird little cult.
Yeah,
and exactly. He's just like
the Branch Davidian of Mandalorians.
Right.
Well, that's the thing. When he meets the sheriff, too, it's like the sheriff comes in, you know, let me buy you a drink. Walks over the table, takes his helmet off, and puts it on the table. And immediately, he's like, you're not a Mandalorian, you know. It's like, it shocks him, like, over and over again, as all these different people, Mandalorian or not, remove their helmets.
Boba Fett did the same thing.
Yeah.
Right? So time and time again. And the Marshal, okay, he was not of Mandalorian, nor was he a foundling, nor a Mandalorian. Boba shows his pedigree,
chain,
I guess. I don't know.
Chain
chain code. Same with Bo-Katan and the other two Mandalorians. And so I think Mando kind of starts to think, well, you know, what does it mean to be a Mandalorian? What, you know, kind of looking at big picture rather than just what do the Branch Davidians think, or Heaven's Gate, or whatever you want to call it. But It's a good episode. I mean, the whole taking the heist, taking over the Imperial weapons ship, and you know, the guy, you know, taking the pill, or well, wasn't a pill, but the suicide charge or whatever it was,
shock treatment, whatever.
It's interesting. You know, obviously there's still Imperial remnants, and there's still this sort of fanatical charge in a lot of them. You know, Moff Gideon, he tells the guy, well, you know what you have to do, and bam, bam, he shoots the pilots and starts to dive the ship in a suicide dive. And it's like, they're still very, you know, they have strong beliefs. Yeah, it's like, it's very interesting.
Also in that episode, we get like the first hint that Bo-Katan is after the Darksaber.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Right.
So, right. So now we know, you know, what her end game is on this. And then we hear, you know, oh, no, it's not this episode. I'm going ahead. Sorry. I will hold my tongue until we jump forward a couple of episodes.
But yeah, we kind of know she's going to be on a collision course with Moff Gideon.
Right. So we finish off this, you know, the Mon Calamari does his best to put the Razor Crest back together. And
That's the greatest thing. It's like, you know, you see him warp at the end, and it's like this little door's floating in space. Little pieces are like falling off as he's, you know, piloting the ship.
And he tells the kid. All right.
Go ahead.
He tells them, you know, we're not going to make it, so I think we're going to have a little pit stop. And they go back to, you know,
Navarro.
Yeah.
I mean, yeah, the thing is literally held together with like ropes and pieces of cloth. And it's just a freaking nightmare.
Yeah. In the beginning of the episode where the Mon Calamari is like, well, I'll refill it. If it holds fuel, it's just tore up.
Yeah, I don't know. I really like the Razor Crest, but we'll get into that later.
It was a nice ship.
But, at times.
Yeah, the next episode, 12, the Siege, I thought that was a really exciting episode. And Carl Weathers directed it. I don't know if that's the first thing he's directed, but I thought that was pretty neat.
Yeah, when I saw that at the end, I was surprised. Plus, you know, it's always hard to direct something that you're acting in.
Mm-hmm.
You're doing double duty, right. But
Well, he's been around a long time, so it figures he's probably, you know, he's picked up a lot of tricks. So,
plus it brings back the alien that Mando caught in the first scene of the first episode.
Right, he's back.
He's back working for him.
Yeah, that was pretty good when Mando walks in and he sees him and all these little jets of moisture shoot.
Now, this is the episode where Grogu takes the kids' cookies in the,
yes,
in the classroom, right?
Yeah.
The little cookie thief, the macaroon thief.
Well, you know, and here's the thing is that throughout the first and second season up to that episode, there's always the potential that a Jedi can go to the dark side. And what is that path? And I don't think stealing is the Jedi way. So I was kind of like a little nervous, like, oh, no. Now, true, the kid with the cookies was a real putz. But with Grogu right in like, yeah, and, you know, force lifting them, I don't know.
Well, you know, people had said, you know, he's fearful. He's, you know, he could go to the dark side. And he did steal the cookies. It's like, I don't think stealing the cookies is the worst thing he's done.
No, I mean, there's still, you know, he's, whether it's the shift knob or the cookies or whatever, it's like, he's a kid. He's, you know, he sees something, he wants it, he takes it.
Right. It's a pretty normal thing for a little kid to do. It's not, you know, they don't have self-control or anything when they're little, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. It's not like he choked the kid to get the cookies. That was
right.
Hey, there you go.
Yeah.
Still in the back of my mind, I was like, not quite the Jedi way. But, this episode had a lot of great development. Harkening back to prior episodes, I mean, all the experiments that they were doing with the kid, with Grogu, cloning, you know, and there were a lot of people on the interwebs were like, wait, is this a caveat or a throwback to the Rise of Skywalker and the cloning dark magic?
Well, I mean, they come across that lab and
you
see the hologram, and that's when you find out, okay, they still want.
Right. I didn't think about that when I first saw it, but maybe.
Yeah, I mean, you got the hologram too, where it's like he explains it right out. They're, you know, they're looking for the kid. They still need his DNA or his blood or whatever to continue in their cloning.
Right.
Yeah.
You know.
And I think that's when Mando realizes, oh man, I left him behind again. I got to get back and get the kid.
I did think it was an attempt to tie into the new trilogy. And maybe it's an attempt to sort of validate it or, you know, I think there's a lot of negative feelings towards the new trilogy. And maybe they thought, well, if we take a popular show like Mandalorian and sort of tie it together, maybe it'll kind of take away some of those negative feelings towards that trilogy. I don't know.
Yeah.
But they sure looked a lot like the clones that were in Rise of Skywalker. So, yeah, I don't know.
I mean, it was a good story. Don't get me wrong. Either way, it works.
Well, it was very exciting to have them go in and raid the base. And they had a lot of fun callbacks to things we had seen before. I mean, when they made the poor schmuck go out on the control pad over the lava, it's like, who are the engineers in the Empire designing these things where you got to go out over the lava to you know, get to the reactor controls? It's
and there's
like,
no guardrail.
Yeah, no guardrail. Okay, great design, guys. But, you know, of course, you're going to watch that and you're going to remember Obi-Wan in Star Wars. And, you know, it's just like, oh, yeah, it's like we've seen this before. And we know the Empire has these crazy control pads that have no guardrails way up over something dangerous. Why? Who knows? No one knows, but we've seen it before. So we know that's the way they do it.
Yeah, you know? Exactly.
And, yeah, you know, it was nice to see Greef Karga and Cara Dune again, and we saw that they'd you know, built the town up. It was really nice. They had the school and everything. And there was like a statue of IG-88 in the town center. I had to go back and look at it again. So that was nice. And nice
Cara
touch.
Dune is the marshal now.
Yeah, little man tear for Larry on that one.
And the chase with the little troop carrier and the TIE fighters.
Speeder bikes. Yeah. I love the speeder bikes going down the hill, and I'm like, oh, man, that is so cool.
Yeah, that was great.
Yeah, and the first two wipe out.
Yeah, well, yeah. That added to the coolness.
Say, here we go, great chase, and then one bumps into a rock and hits the other, and they both blow up.
I mean, this gets back to what you were saying, Bob, about it feeling like a movie every week. It really does feel like you get a Star Wars movie every week.
For 8 weeks, and then you have to wait.
Yeah, then we all have to, you know, go through our withdrawal symptoms for a while until we get something else cool to watch.
See, this is where Disney Plus, you know, it's like, okay, Mandalorian just ended. They should have something to pick up right away, whether it's WandaVision or something, you know. Keep the new stuff coming. Keep people excited. Because now, are a lot of people dropping Disney Plus again to pick it up again next year, you know.
It might just be, you know, the over geek in me, but I enjoy that behind the scenes series. It's not Imagineering, although the Imagineering series on Disney Plus is great too.
What, the Marvel 616 or?
That's a good one too, but they have this
series. Well, they had a round table with the directors from Mandalorian from last season.
Yeah. Yeah, that's the series. I can't think of the name of it, but they.
The gallery or.
Yeah, the Disney Gallery or something like that. And they have the round table with the directors. They get into they didn't just do blue screen. They actually had like these huge monitors that they would backlight or light up. And that was the scenery of the planet. And so they were able to limit their travel budgets. And then they were saying that going into the filming of the second season, they were able to utilize that by, you know, filming different actors in different parts of the screen so that they weren't violating any COVID. Mm-hmm. You know, I'll tell you what, they didn't want Tom Cruise jumping in there and chewing him out. So they.
That's right.
Yeah, I think they called that the volume.
The volume, yes. So
yeah, I'm that thing was crazy.
Hopefully they do it again for this season.
I heard they were going to do it. I don't know if they were going to have a multi-part show or just a special, but they're going to do some kind of follow-up.
Because the last one was like 8 parts. They did like one episode on each episode or on each director as they, you know, went through their episode. But
yeah, so I'm hoping, you know, we get one or more of those this go round. You know, there's the new Pixar movie coming out. There's not that I'm advocating that you keep your Disney subscription active.
Well, isn't WandaVision coming out
like
in January?
Middle of January, I think.
Okay. So it's not too long.
Yeah.
So what about the next episode?
The Jedi.
That was a good one.
That was amazing. I'm a big, big fan of Ahsoka Tano. Again, a Filoni creation, Dave Filoni for the Clone Wars, and you know, she's famously Anakin Skywalker's only Padawan learner, and Rosario Dawson did such an epic.
Well, plus it's, you know, the samurai feel of the entire episode. You know, like it was mm-hmm. like right out of a samurai film, and it was great.
Total Kurosawa feel to it. I agree with you. I mean, it was just like, wow.
And Diana Lee Inosanto.
Amazing, amazing performance.
Do you know where she's from or her mm-hmm. background? Diana Lee basically got the middle name from Bruce Lee. Inosanto, he was a student of Bruce Lee. It's his daughter.
Yeah.
He's the one who introduced Bruce Lee to the nunchucks. And then he also, if you ever saw Game of Death, mm-hmm. and Bruce Lee has to make his way up the different floors of the building before he battles Kareem Abdul-Jabbar at the top. One of those floors was Danny Nosanto with the nunchucks fighting him. And so, yeah, just her lineage is, you know, classic. So to have her in the episode was really cool.
Saw the movie and played the game back in the 80s.
Oh, we could go on a whole episode on Game of Death. That was the way that was kind of patched together and all. But
yeah. Well, we might have to do a Bruce Lee episode one of these days.
Fine by me.
I got my collector's edition DVD set, so.
My father-in-law's.
I mean, Ahsoka, again, one of my favorite characters in Star Wars, so I was really excited to see how they would bring her to live action, and it did not disappoint. That beginning was just perfect with the mist and the trees and everything, and it was just a great episode. The way they joined forces, her interactions with the child, and then finding out the name and a little bit of his backstory, having been at the temple. So it actually kind of raises more questions than it answers, because now we know that Grogu was basically at the temple probably in the time of the prequels, may have known Yoda, is maybe connected to Yoda, has, you know, it could be a father, who knows?
Well, I mean, if this takes place 5 years after Jedi, and Grogu is supposedly like 50 years old, so yeah, he would have been right there through the whole thing with Yoda and all.
Right.
Because they said the Empire lasted for something like 30 years, because a lot of people were trying to figure out, well, if Luke and Leia are this old, and Vader is this, then Obi-Wan would be how old? Then when did episode 3 take place? So, in any case, without getting into the numbers game, yes, Grogu is the kid's name. And the Mandalorian has such delight in saying, Grogu? Grogu? What?
The hell do you want?
And yet again, we find a new force power that we were not aware of before, where two Jedi or two Force users can communicate with each other, and that's how we learned the baby's name.
That's true. I hadn't thought about that.
Yeah, because they're just kind of sitting there staring at each other. They're not really talking or signing or anything else. It was just...
Right. Kind of just communing through the Force.
Yeah.
And, you know, one of the things I will say, as much as I love Ahsoka, in... Return of the Jedi, when Yoda tells Luke, when gone am I, last of the Jedi will you be? And then, you know, before you go, but there is another. What? Your sister? So we were led to believe at Return of the Jedi there were just two Jedi left, whereas, well, no, there might be one or two or three or four. it's okay. I love Ahsoka. I love the idea that there are more than just one Jedi left in the Star Wars universe.
Well, technically she left the Jedi because they were such putzes to her. They didn't believe in her. They kind of threw her to the wolves, and then they said, oh, you can come back and join us, and she's like, nope, not interested.
Yeah. Whoops, so we made a mistake.
Yeah, she wasn't a Jedi. She said forget it, and she did her own thing. So
well, that is true. But in any case, the whole concept of her training Grogu to become a Jedi and the Mandalorian thinking, you know, there was that one scene where, you know, okay, kid, this is goodbye. And this is, and, you know, the man tears started welling up. I'm like, oh, you know, there's this Jerry Lewis movie called Geisha Boy. Yeah, where he has this little kid that, you know, grows on him, and Jerry Lewis plays this magician, and the gag in the movie is that his rabbit Harry is almost like a Bugs Bunny, even though it's a real rabbit. It's like more human than animal, and he loses the rabbit, and the rabbit doesn't want to like do stuff in the magic act. Anyway, Jerry Lewis has to say goodbye to the kid, and it just totally, it gets to me now. I'm getting a little verklempt thinking about it. But anyway, Mando's saying goodbye to the kid, and then Ahsoka says, you know, I'm jumping ahead, though. Wasn't there like this huge battle in the town?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
I forgot to mention. Sorry, guys.
Skip over all the action here.
I did skip over all the action. Straight to the man tears.
But no, well, I mean, it was basically, it was a great battle in the city and the big samurai standoff at the end. And actually, you had two standoffs. You had Mando in a Western style standoff. Mm-hmm. And then you had Ahsoka in the like samurai classic type standoff.
Yeah, it was cool that they decided to team up and, you know, go ahead and rescue the villagers, basically. And I was thinking, is that why Ahsoka was there? To rescue these villagers? What's the big deal with the villagers? Ah, but there's more. She was after information to go find anyone?
Well, Grand Admiral Thrawn.
Again, amazing that they're bringing this character who we saw in the animated series Rebels, but this was part of the novelization part of the Star Wars galaxy, which Disney annexed a lot of that stuff, of those books and those characters. But Grand Admiral Thrawn survived that purge. And now is in, you know, Star Wars proper canon. Very exciting. Very exciting news when I saw that.
Well, she's getting her own series, so that might be the jump off point for that.
That could be, you know, maybe Sabine's going to be part of that and they go after Ezra. I mean, that might be the continuation of that story. They may go in a completely different direction. I love kind of going back again. Sorry, the discussion she had with why she can't train Grogu and, you know, there's fear and explaining that the greatest of us can fall. We have to be careful in who we train. And that was, you know, talking about Anakin. God, what an amazing series. Just tying all this legacy, you know, across different chapters and different stories and characters. It's just a wonderful, wonderful time to be a fan.
Well, she sort of screws Mando in a sense because she says she'll train him if he helps her out with fighting the forces in the city, which he does. But then, you know, at the end, she's like, you know, I can't train him. He's got an attachment to you, but, you know, you could go do this other thing. And I thought, well, you know, that seems kind of like a passing the buck part. And I do think it's sort of her hang up is like, yeah, her master, you know, became a Dark Lord, and so she's very averse to training anybody who shows any fear. So,
well, and like you said, she's had bad history with the Jedi. So I think what she gave him ultimately worked out a hell of a lot better.
Well,
for Grogu, but you know, Mando. To his credit, he understood it, and maybe part of it is he wanted to keep the kid around longer, you know, and extend that journey. He loved that kid. I mean, it was like that. Like I said, if you get a chance to watch Yeesha Boy with Jerry Lewis, you're going to see a lot of similarities.
Jeez. Well, and I don't want to miss that. We started to talk about the two showdowns. What about Michael Biehn being in the episode?
Yes, that was another good cameo guest star. He has quite the pedigree. Terminator, Aliens. I mean, you know, Kyle freaking Reese was in this episode. That's like gold.
Yeah. And he's, you know, he pulls a pretty slimy move on Mando there, right. But like Bob, you know, like Bob said, it was total Western showdown.
Well, yeah, that was classic Western, just, you know, putting the gun down and okay, I give up, and then pulling the other gun and getting shot. I mean, yeah, it's Go back to all your spaghetti westerns. You saw
I was
going to
say you could almost insert the music.
But no, I mean,
but that was a lot of fun.
But yeah, I mean, it basically played off their backgrounds because he's basically a Western character and she's a samurai type character. So,
right.
As a lot of the Jedi is, are.
Are, yeah. So.
Yes. An interesting juxtaposition of the two genre.
Plus, he gets his Beskar spear.
Yeah, that is pretty cool. I like the
seemed like kind of like a offhanded thing until later on.
Well, right. So we are going to now take Grogu to Typhon. Typhon, we're told, has a temple, an ancient temple, a Jedi temple. And Ahsoka says, take Grogu there and he can tap into the Force and reach out. And if he wants to find a Jedi or whatever, Jedi magic, the Metachlorians. Oh, woo. I said the M word.
Yeah.
His M count.
Right. So, and then what really like surprised me pleasantly is who shows up to confront Mando? Boba Fett.
Boba Fett.
Yeah.
And God, I mean, that actor is the same guy who played Jango Fett, which makes sense because he was the source of the clones and, you know, the clone warriors and everything. And I love that he looks beaten up. He takes off the mask. He's scarred. I mean, he survived the Sarlacc.
Yeah, that's the digestive juices of the Sarlacc is no joke.
No joke. It digested the bottom part of his armor. All he had left was the top armor.
Well, I mean, you saw how beat up and dinged up that armor was, so you got to figure how beat up and dinged up he was underneath it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and I mean, look, to be fair, if we take a look at Mando and how he got out of the crate dragon, you know, maybe Boba had a thermal detonator or something that he was able to finagle his way. Will we ever learn what happened? Maybe. But in any case, there's Boba. And he has a very good conversation with Mando. Whether or not he was willing to kill Grogu or not, or it was just the threat, we'll never know. But what is the saying? The enemy of my enemy is my friend. So when the Empire, the remnants of the Empire, show up, oh, that's right, because those bastards put a tracking device on the Razor Crest.
Yep.
Ah. One of the oldest tricks in the Empire's book. I'm surprised they didn't disable the hyperdrive. But anyway, this was a great episode. And the thing is after the excitement and the hoopla of Ahsoka Tano and that whole Jedi story, what direction were they going to go? My fear was it wasn't going to be as exciting an episode. But honestly, in my book, it was more exciting than the prior episode. It really built on a whole nother structure and story revolving Grogu's journey.
Well, we had that hint of Boba Fett in the first episode. We had to wait, what, 5 or 6 before it paid off?
5, right. Yeah.
I didn't even think it would be this season, honestly. I thought, well, maybe he'll come at the end. Maybe he would show up working for Moff Gideon.
Right.
You know, I just did not see him coming back at this point, and I never saw him teaming up with Mando, so that was a real surprise.
It was epic. And then Fennec shows up as well.
Yeah, that was bizarre. She opens up and she's got like all these pistons and stuff. <It's> like, okay, sure. Why not? Let's go with it.
All right. Yeah, well, hey, you know, if Boba could survive the Sarlacc, she survived. Who knows what's under Boba's shirt? But anyway, I'm glad they didn't show us any of that. One of the things that I liked was his fighting style, because they start fighting, you know, the stormtroopers land and mayhem ensues and the enemy of my enemy is my friend. And he was like beating the crap out of these stormtroopers with a gaffy stick. And it was like a Maori kind of feel to it, you know, the way that he battled them. I don't know if you guys picked up on that or not.
Well, I mean, I have to say the fights in The Mandalorian, the kind of refreshing thing about them is, unlike other action films and action series, not everybody knows martial arts.
Mm-hmm.
You know, mm-hmm. a lot of, you know, like Mandalorian, you know, Mando's fighting style is just basically he's punching, you know, once in a while he'll kick, but, you know, he's not doing big roundhouse kicks and flips and, you know, karate mm-hmm. chops and whatever. It's like, because, you know, most it's like, oh yeah, they know martial arts too, you know. That's like the only exciting fighting style people can think of. Whereas, yeah, I mean, this is more Western. It's more Western type stunt fighting.
Yeah, exactly. It was great.
Yeah, Boba really went to town with that gaffy stick. I mean, it was pretty brutal attacks on those stormtroopers. And again, being Disney, there's not like blood flying everywhere, but you know, those helmets were shattered.
Yeah, there's plastics flying everywhere.
And yeah, Bob, I think you're right. You know, when you think about fighting styles, you know, you don't see Mando, you know, doing like flying sidekicks or stuff like that. They kind of cater it to each character. Like Cara Dune gets very physical with people, but it's not, you know, it's fits her body type, right? So she's a big lady. So she's like kind of shoving people around and slamming them and stuff. And, you know, whereas with some of the other folks, they are doing more of sort of like sidekicks, or they're, you know, knocking people's knees out or whatever. They're more agile. They're smaller. So they do some of the more kind of gymnastic stuff. But it makes sense, whatever they're doing, for, you know, who they are, their size and their background.
No, definitely.
Yeah. And, you know, we kind of see in a later episode more of a close combat thing with Boba Fett and another character and the different styles. Right. Because one is smaller than him and jumping around like a little monkey. And he's just kind of like this tree in the forest kind of.
Well, it was funny once he got his armor back. That was definitely his little star moment, you know, because I think everybody wanted to see a Boba Fett at the height of his powers. And man, he had all kinds of gadgets flying off of him, shooting stuff at people. And of course, the finale where he takes, I thought it was a little far-fetched where he took down the two troop transports. But, you know, they gave him his big star moment that his Boba Fett fans wanted. So
yeah, but that was a funny thing though, because like Mando's like, oh, nice shot, and he's like, oh, I was shooting for the other one.
I was aiming for the other ship.
Right, he's got that gravelly voice. I saw an interview or read an interview with Tamara Morrison about his return to the role, and of course he couldn't reveal anything about the fact that apparently he's going to be doing a lot more. But he said, to your point, Larry, that, yeah, he did want to include a little bit of his heritage in the fighting style. And then he said he also, you know, they talked to him about how he had come back from the Sarlacc pit. And he said, well, I thought I should have a gravelly voice. So he purposely put a little gravel in his sound.
I think the thing that amazed me most was, in between episodes, he was able to repaint his armor.
Maybe he found a droid somewhere and threatened him.
Could have been Stark Tech that he borrowed from Spider-Man.
That's right. Yeah, I think Boba Fett's in Spider-Man 3 as well, right?
Returning, reprising his role as Boba Fett in Spider-Man 3. Tamara Morrison. Yes. Oh,
good one.
Oh, Lord.
It all ties together. It's all Disney now.
Exactly. It's Jon Favreau's. It all ties together.
I'm going to be in Spider-Man 3 too, you putzes.
Well, Spider-Man 3 is kind of the Spider-Verse, so, you know, you could have a Spider-Mouse in there.
Yeah.
Damn right.
Oh, my gosh.
Man, so this brings us to
the destruction of the Razor Crest.
Oh,
that
man.
Surprised the crap out of me.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, that thing was just like blown to bits. I mean, all he found, right, was like the Beskar spear was like the only thing left.
His massive Mandalorian electrical gun was gone.
Ah, that was sad.
Oh,
and the knob off the gear shift.
Oh, baby man tier moment when he found the knob in his little pouch.
Show Larry a shift knob and it's all over.
Oh, God. But mayhem ensues. Or Grogu, the little force protection. Oh, I don't know what that thing was.
Force field?
A force field. The communing tube.
Yeah. Was it a force field or was it, it was supposed to be some means of sending out a signal to the Jedi or whatever, but.
Yeah. The Mandalorian Mando couldn't, reach in there and grab it, kept on getting thrown away. So it goes down just at the time that the dark troopers.
Yeah, he tuckers out just at the right time.
Yeah.
Or just at the wrong time,
timing, maybe. Right?
You know, those dark troopers looked like, when I was a kid, I really enjoyed the Micronauts, the little toys. Baron. Do you remember Baron Karza?
Yes, I have that figure still.
And of course, Baron Karza was supposed to look sort of like Darth Vader, so I guess it all goes in a circle.
Baron Karza and Force Commander.
Yep.
And we'll talk about Micronauts in another episode, I'm sure. But yeah, they did. I guess they're based off of a video game, is what I read.
Yeah, I heard that as well. That they were in a Star Wars video game, which I haven't played yet. So
yeah. But then, so our dear Grogu, there's a great moment, too, going back to the beginning of the episode where he's like, well, we're not going to be able to land by the temple. We're going to have to get there by other means. And the kids in the arms of the Mandalorian going, whee!
We got to go with the windows down.
Yeah, I got to go with the windows down. Yeah, that was cool seeing him fly over there with his jetpack, which he takes off. Because Boba, threatens him. And then, of course, because he doesn't have the jetpack, he can't fly back up there and stop the dark troopers from taking Grogu. So.
Oh, but going back to a previous episode, though, there's that scene where, a bunch of aliens show up to get the kid. And the one, trades the kid for the jetpack. And he's as he's walking off with the jetpack, Mando just, touches his wrist and the jetpack and the guy just take off into the sky and you see the guy just fall hundreds of feet, splat on the ground and then here comes the jetpack.
I want to say it was not a Jedi. It was a Jawa, mercenary or something. And it would have been great if when he hit the jetpack, you heard a Utini.
Well, yeah, that one, it was funny, Bob. I was thinking about that when we went past the episode, and I thought, oh, I forgot to mention that. That was a funny moment. And of course, he's got Grogu in his arms, and he kind of looks up at him like, you really did that. Like, it was kind of like, and it's like Mando just kind of shrugs.
Well, it's funny because I can't remember who coined the phrase. Maybe it was Spielberg, like a Disney moment. And usually, in the Disney films, you'd have a bunch of guys running, and there's always one guy trailing behind. Yeah. Or close encounters, or where the ships went around the hill, and there was that one little ship trailing behind. Mm-hmm. And in this one, it's the jetpack makes a really nice landing, and then a couple of seconds later, it just falls over.
Yeah.
It's kind of that delayed, kind of humorous moment at the end. That same with when the Razor Crest went into warp and that little door or whatever is floating behind in space, but
yeah, that was a great moment.
So back into the episode we're in.
Jumping back, the kids on board the Moff Gideon's is it an Imperial ship or a remnant ship?
Yeah, I think they said it was a light cruiser.
Okay.
Not a full Star Destroyer.
And he's confronted then by, was it that episode where Moff Gideon talks to him, or is it the beginning of the next episode? I'm thinking it's at the end of the the tragedy where he shows him the dark saber and he's like, oh, right, because he's throwing those stormtroopers left and right.
Yeah, because they stun him at the end and put him to sleep or whatever. But
yeah, and I'm thinking, don't turn to the dark side, kid.
Yeah, but he seemed to pretty much enjoy flipping those stormtroopers back and forth and over and under and around and up and down.
Yeah, that was a little disconcerting.
Well, who knows what they were doing to him before, you know? Because you had that one last season, you had that one stormtrooper where Grogu was in the bag and he's like punching the bag.
Yeah.
So you could have, you know, another one or two sadistic stormtroopers doing God knows what.
Yeah. So, well, you know, one of the things that was kind of inconsistent for me was Ahsoka telling Mando, Grogu's afraid to use his powers because he doesn't want people to know, but maybe he felt threatened. And so that's why he started choking them and throwing them around. It was more of a defensive.
You have to decide when you cross that line.
Yeah. And, you know, he's a 50-year-old kid, so he doesn't know any better.
Yeah.
So we leave Chapter 14, the tragedy, and we go to, what is it, The Believer, Chapter 15. And Marshall Dune, we come to find out.
Yes.
Uses her new standing in the New Republic to transfer Prisoner Mayfield into her charge. Mando's asking her, hey, you know, can you get a hold of Mayfield? And she's like, you know, I don't know. And he says, oh, they got the kid. And she's like all in. And once again, we see like not an Imperial walker, but kind of like that frame used to ferry, like, what is it, like junk?
Mm-hmm. Used like a crane.
Yeah. Which was really cool. I thought it's those little details that, you know what I forgot to talk about too, or we forgot to talk about in the prior episode, when, you know, everything is done, Mando shows the lineage of, you know, his father was Jango and the armor and whatever.
You mean Boba?
Boba, sorry, to Mando. And Mando like accepts it and like, oh, okay, you know, you can keep the armor. And then Bob had said, well, the armor got a fresh new coat of paint. I mean, that armor looked more new than it did in Empire Strikes Back when we originally met Boba Fett. But hey, they got bigger budgets in this series. Hey, what can I say?
Who knows how long it took him to get from one planet to the other. He might have had a lot of time on his hands and a few paints, a few cans of paint in the bottom of the ship and
in anticipation of eventually getting his armor back.
It fit him a lot better, too.
It's red and green. It could have been like, you know, leftover Christmas paint or something.
So they get Mayfield and they decide that he can figure out where Moff Gideon's ship is.
Because he still had the Imperial codes.
Yeah. So what is there? An Imperial mining hub on the planet Morak, which kind of reminded me of Space Giants. The evil
Rodak.
Rodak. Cousin to Morak. But anyway. So, you know, Mayfield in the first season, he did an okay job, but he didn't really strike me as anything extraordinary. And I was kind of puzzled, honestly, why did they pick him, you know, to be the one to be the person with the Imperial or access to the Imperial codes and all that stuff? They could have picked anyone.
That episode in the first season with the prisoners was probably my least favorite episode from the first season. So I was not looking forward to this because I thought, oh, they're going to bring that guy in and he's so obnoxious. But boy, did I do a 180 on that.
Yeah, and he was really good in this episode. And he's sort of the one that I think convinces Mando that, you know, hey, it's okay to take this armor off, you know.
Yeah, that whole conversation about why do you have the helmet on? to cover your face, or, you know, to hide your what?
Is the rule that you have to cover your face, or is the rule that you have to wear the helmet? And, you know, have you even thought about these things? I mean, the title was The Believer, and there's a lot of moments in this episode about how people's belief systems affect not only their lives, but other people's lives.
Well, he already broke one rule by taking the Mando armor off and putting on the Stormtrooper armor.
Right. All for the kid. You know, in an earlier episode, they're having soup or some kind of a meal on the Razor Crest, and it's just Mando and the kid. And Mando doesn't take off his helmet. He lifts it a little so he can eat. So, you know, he took this very, very seriously.
So the kid was, like, trying to take a peek at that time.
Well, I thought that was odd, because I thought that as long as they were among their own family, they could take their helmet off. That was my impression. But, you know, apparently, I don't know if that's the case or this Mando takes it super seriously. But then, you know, this episode tells us exactly how far he's willing to go.
Right.
For the kid. And that obviously the kid is the most important thing in his life, period.
So we actually find that out at the end in his little speech to Moff Gideon.
Yeah, exactly. I'm starting everything. To think about everything, and I'm just kind of choking up here, so bear with me.
Well, and yeah, he basically takes Moff Gideon's words and throws them back in his face, right? But it has much more meaning.
Well, I think the great thing about that speech is Moff Gideon is just speechless.
Right.
He's not standing there going, "Oh, no, you won't." Yeah, he's just like standing there like, "Oh, crap."
Yeah, he probably never thought anybody would have the balls to stand up to him to say, I'm coming after you.
And maybe he didn't realize the attachment that the two of them had until that point.
Right.
I mean, the other aspect of this episode, which was really stunning to me, was the fact that we had people talking about, you know, when Mayfeld is sitting there with his former commanding officer, and that guy is such a piece of crap. And he's going on about, all these people, well, they died for the glory of the Empire and blah, blah, blah. And Mayfeld is obviously, you know, he's a guy who's distressed. Maybe he's still having PTSD from all the stuff he went through, you know, but he's just like, well, was it good for them? Was it good for all the people who died? Was it, you know, we saw some stuff in Rogue One where you realized the impact that, you know, the wars were taking on people. But, you know, basically, like, Star Wars has always been just about fun and, you know, bang, bang, here's stuff going on and it's just for fun. But they've given us some things here where it's like, oh, okay, you're throwing some more kind of adult material at us a little bit, which was really unexpected, you know. And the actor there, Bill Barr, did a really good job kind of delivering that. And I mean, I did not. At a certain point, you knew, oh, my God, he's probably going to shoot this guy. And you see Mando, like, shaking his head a little bit, like, what are you doing? Yeah. But I didn't expect anything like that from this episode. I just figured it's another action-packed episode. So that was really intriguing.
Well, the other kind of underlying thing in the episode that was perfect was the way he acted once he took the helmet off. And then suddenly he realizes he's got to sit down for a meal with this guy. And the whole time he looks so damn uncomfortable, almost like you're sitting there naked.
Right.
Yeah.
You know, like, what do I do? What do I say?
Yeah, no. And I think the way that Mayfield asserted, look, I didn't see your face after everything was said and done. One of the things that struck me, too, is when they were talking to his ex-Imperial commander. Most of the Imperial commanders that we've seen in Star Wars thus far are always British, you know.
Yeah.
We will attack the target and we, you know, we'll have tea afterwards. This guy sounded like the redneck in, what's the name of the movie? George Kennedy, Steve McQueen, and it's, Anyway, the guy's like, what we have here is failure to communicate.
Cool Hand Luke?
Cool Hand Luke. And I hated that guy. He was in charge of the prisoners. This Imperial commander reminded me of him. Well, there was glory to the Empire. And it was a great day. And I'm like, oh, shoot him. Shoot him.
And then all hell breaks loose.
Exactly, Bob. All hell breaks loose.
Yeah, it was quite a scene. You know, he shoots him, and then everybody's just kind of like, what?
Yeah. I mean, the plan was to sneak in, sneak out, right?
Yeah.
Now it's a, like, sneak in and shoot out.
Yeah, exactly.
You just have to get to the top of the facility, and then Boba's ship would come in, and...
Bada bing, bada boom.
Yeah.
You know, again, the detail, I was looking at this the second time I watched this episode when they're escaping to the roof and there are little ledges, you know, and the building is mostly made out of what looks like cement. And you can see where pools of water, whether it was rain or a broken drain or whatever, that kind of colored the cement in different ways. And there were little cracks here and there. It was like more details than you needed to have in a half hour TV show. You know what I mean? It was so impressive to me. It really, that's the stuff that draws you in, you know, visually.
Yeah.
Well, that kind of harkens back to the original Star Wars and George Lucas's whole thing of, I don't want, you know, pristine ships. I want ships that have, they're beaten and they're dinged up and scratched and,
mm-hmm. you know.
Exactly.
So the whole, you know, the whole universe of Star Wars became that.
Yeah, it's lived in. It's been there a while.
Right. And it just gives that sense of reality, sense of belonging, if you will. You know, we're part of that universe. We're living it with them, if you will. Although as a voyeuristic kind of viewer.
We're living in it on our couches.
There, yeah.
Well, and now it was really exciting, though, when they escaped. And Boba used the sonic charge. I'm not a big fan of the prequels, but I always loved that sound effect.
Yes.
Wow. It was like, oh, my God. They're just giving us what we want.
Fan service.
Yeah.
That moment
of silence where everything just, you know, the ship was just shooting. And then... Like, oh my God.
There's good ways to do fan service. I mean, you know, I mean, actually, this whole series, if you think about it, is fan service. They didn't have to give us a show that would, you know, bring the Star Wars universe to TV, but they did. So,
well, the whole thing is just Favreau and Filoni, like, two kids sitting on the floor with their Star Wars toys and, you know, okay. And then Boba Fett comes flying in and then, you know,
you know, Bob, I would love to have a conversation with those two and ask them, did you ever play any of this out with your toys when you were kids? You know, did you know?
They're playing with it now.
Boba Fett survived. That would be interesting.
And you could tell Filoni's background, you know, in that series you were talking about earlier where they talked to each of the directors and, you know, yeah, you could just tell he was like having a blast just throwing stuff in.
Oh man. I mean, who wouldn't, right? I mean, if they had the three of us working on a Star, we should do an episode. If we were to do a Star Wars show, who would be in it and what would our first episode entail?
Well, that's kind of what Spider-Man 3 is going to be. So let's move on to the last episode because we're like,
I was gonna say okay kids, this gets us into The Rescue, chapter 16, episode 8 of the second season. So you know, it opens up with an Imperial shuttle being chased by Slave One, and it's like, oh man, who do we find out is on that shuttle but that freaking Dr. Pershing, the clone guy.
Freaking Dr. Pershing, forever known as freaking Dr. Pershing.
And again, we get a glimpse into a loyal Imperial soldier. I mean, he shoots the co-pilot because he's like, the co-pilot's like, oh, we're not, look, we're not ironclad onto this. Well, we can negotiate. He's like, no, we can't.
Well, yeah, it's the ideologies again, right? This guy really believes. It's just like the Valen Hess, the officer was talking about. They don't want freedom. They want order, right? So, right. You know, the two ideologies, freedom and order.
Bringing order to the universe.
Mm-hmm.
Plus, he admitted that he was on the original Death Star.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Because he's talking about Alderaan and the fact that it doesn't exist and Mandalore doesn't exist. And
I don't know why he would push Cara Dune like that. She's got a gun on him and... You know,
well, he had a gun on Pershing, though, and he was just like, I think he thought he had the upper hand, and he was just gloating away.
Yeah.
What a dumbass.
Exactly.
But it is interesting that he's like sitting there saying, you know, millions died on the Death Star, and you know, a bunch of terrorists. He called the people of Alderaan terrorists. So they're pointing us to different viewpoints. And even in the previous episode, you know, when Mando and Mayfeld make it in with the truck, we see all the guys, you know, cheering, and, you know, they're TIE fighter pilots and stormtroopers all cheering and stuff. It's like, it makes you think a little bit, like, to the grunts, it's like, hey, this is our side, and, you know, we're doing the right thing.
Well, yeah, it's like, you know, whatever side you're on, whether you're good or evil or not or whatever, you always think what you're doing is right.
Right.
You believe in the cause, and that's what that guy, you know, he believed in the cause. Even though there was no emperor per se, he still believed, I guess, in what the empire stood for.
Right.
And whatever he understood it to be. I mean,
they were going to come back.
Right.
Well, that's what he was brought up and trained and everything else. So.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So this episode just starts off, you know, with a bang, just exciting, a million miles a minute, if you will. And they catch up to Moff Gideon. You know, they use the Imperial shuttle and they, you know, fake Boba Fett shooting at them. And
wait a second. They go and meet Bo-Katan and her lieutenant. Right.
Sorry about that. I skipped over that part. So go ahead, Walker. They meet Bo-Katan. They have a discussion.
Yeah, which was pretty interesting because it was kind of cool to see Mando and Boba Fett kind of stomp into this bar and everybody starts clearing out. And then they have a little altercation with Bo-Katan. And I do not remember the name of her lieutenant there.
Koska Reeves.
Koska Reeves. And she smarts off, they smart off a little bit to Boba because they know his history, that he's a clone. And she makes some nasty remarks to him about, he says something about his father. This is my father's armor. And she's like, oh, don't you mean your donor?
Yeah.
And man, she's a very unlikable character, I got to say.
she plays it well. She did the same thing with the Starbuck character in Battlestar Galactica. I thought there's moments where you think she's vulnerable and you feel for her. And there are other moments where you just hate her, you know, choice of actions that she takes.
And then they have the little fight between Boba and Koska. And that was kind of interesting. I think you kind of referred to it earlier.
Yeah, that was the big tree and the little monkey jumping around. Just kind of like falling like a ton of bricks.
But, you know, again, then Mando basically says, well, we know where Moff Gideon is. And you know, Bo-Katan is all concerned about Gideon and the Darksaber. And Mando's just like, look, I don't care about any of that. I just want the kid. So it's clear that, you know, he doesn't care about the Mandalorian homeworld. He doesn't care about being the ruler, getting the Darksaber, any of that. He just wants to get the kid back.
Yeah, he doesn't care about Gideon. He doesn't care about the Empire. Nothing. The kid.
Mm-hmm.
And, I mean, that kind, you know, in love and devotion that he has that's what, you know, just even now, I feel like just breaking down and having a good sob. I mean, that
well,
is,
hold on, because it's going to get even worse for you.
So I know, I know. I'm going to defer back to you guys right now while I collect myself.
But I mean, you know, yeah, I mean, getting on the light cruiser, and then we see that they have like an entire room full of, you know, the dark troopers.
I know, you're just like, oh crap.
Mando was supposed to like disarm the door or whatever, and he was too late. One squeezes through and gives him a really good fight. Oof. And you realize, well, there's a whole lot more in there.
And how did he get rid of them? He flushes them into space. And I'm like, wait a minute, they have jetpacks and they don't need oxygen.
Well, yeah, that's how they come back later.
Yeah, you knew it was going to be a problem. Yeah, he got the crap beaten out of him. It was pretty brutal, but that Beskar spear came in handy, thankfully.
Yeah, I'm surprised he didn't have a concussion after getting his head beaten out of that helmet.
Oh, man. Yeah.
Yeah, well, I mean, the helmet didn't give at all.
No.
The wall behind it was giving.
Right.
But you got to figure his noggin was probably going back and forth like a ping pong ball or something.
You guys can't see this, but as Bob's talking, his head's bobbing back.
Yeah.
Bob bobblehead.
That's right. But I'm sure he got shook around pretty good inside that helmet while the pile driver was taking his course.
So what did you guys think when Mando makes it to Grogu? And who should be standing over Grogu holding the black saber to him but Moff Gideon?
Well, it had to come down to that.
Oh, man.
That could have been the finale right there.
I thought it was going to be
him fighting
the episode came on.
Oh, that would have been a rough finale to go to.
But then you realize that you're only like maybe a halfway through the episode at that point.
My original prediction was I thought that we'd end on a cliffhanger, and I thought they would duel, and it would either be inconclusive or Mando would lose and Moff Gideon would take off with the kid. So I was totally surprised by how that wound up.
But then again, Moff Gideon was like, I've got his blood. I don't need him. Here, take him. Yeah.
Yeah, that was a big surprise.
You know, and I'm gullible because I totally bought it. I'm like, oh, thank God. You know,
oh, Mando was probably thinking, well, was that easy?
Yeah.
If
yeah,
I knew
that
was that easy, I would have just called him up. You know,
I thought that was a little strange. It was one of those moments where they sort of need the character to do something a little dumb, where he's like, okay, I'll just turn my back on you and pick up the kid. It was like, what? This guy's a bounty hunter. He's been everywhere. I don't know. I thought that it was necessary for the plot.
Hmm.
So that I was kind of like, what? He's just going to, you know, let the guy walk away. So, yeah, it didn't work 100%, but, you know, I let it go.
That's the one thing about lightsabers, though. It's like you can't really sneak up on someone with a lightsaber.
Well, and, you know, I was just so gullible. I was like, oh, yay, he's got the baby. And then that bastard just started, like, wailing on him with that dark saber. Thankfully, he hit him only on parts of his body that were covered in Beskar and not in between. So,
well, I think Moff Gideon didn't realize at first. And then Mando was trying to, you know, he was blocking. So, yeah, he was trying.
Yeah.
He knew he couldn't, like, throw his elbow out there.
Well, and as if things couldn't get worse, right? The trip alarms or whatever go off on the bridge, which is where all the other heroes are, and those damn dark troopers are boarding the ship. So Mando, you know, real quick, well, not real quickly, but he bests Moff Gideon, gets the kid. They run up to the bridge. And those of you that are familiar with Mandalorian culture realize the big mistake that Mando made. So anyway, Moff Gideon, the smug little troll that he is, explains, you know, because they're like, what do you do with the dark saber? And, you know,
yeah, he's like trying to give it to her. Here, take it.
Well, you know, and we can talk about that because, you know, the ruler of Mandalore has to win the saber in combat. Mando won the saber in combat, and he explains that it's the story. It's not the saber that has the power in it and this, that, and the other. And Mando's like, okay, I yield. Take it. I mean, look, well, anyway.
I actually thought he was going to, like, let her fight him and then just kind of, like, fake give in or whatever. And you won. Here you go.
I mean, you could do that, but it wouldn't really be a just battle. I mean, Moff Gideon tried to kill Mando. Mando didn't kill Gideon because he promised Bo-Katan the kill. That's what he thought she wanted. Because I'm trying to think of, like, excuses. Like, well, yeah, just fake it, you know. And but no, she'd really have to best him.
Yeah, but in Rebels, Sabine had the saber, and she gave it to Bo-Katan, and they didn't fight. So I'm not sure. Again, it's like, what's the rule? Do you have to wear the helmet, or do you have to give them the saber? You have to win the saber. So
right.
Maybe. But then again, you've got all these dark troopers outside the door pounding away at the blast door.
So here comes.
And they're all getting ready. They're holding up their guns. And they're gonna, you know, here comes the big battle. And then
they're beating the door. They close the blast doors, but they're coming through. And Gideon says there's a platoon of dark troopers on their way to the bridge, but none of you will survive.
And then, look, an X-Wing.
X-Wing shows up, and everyone kind of collectively, we gasped.
I almost jumped off the couch.
Well, see, it was like, you know, before the episode, I was saying that he was throwing out all those signals to the Jedi. So some Jedi's got to show up, right?
Some Jedi had to show up.
I did not think it would be the Jedi.
So did you guys have any theory that, you know, I know there's a lot of stuff going on in the internet. Earlier offline, I thought it was going to be Ezra Pritchard from Rebels.
I had put on my blog that I hoped it would be Luke, but I didn't think we would see full body Luke in the episode. I thought, oh, maybe we'll hear his voice, or maybe we'll see him in, you know, the cloak, but not the face or something. I really, really hoped it would be Luke because of the time, and sort of he seemed like the most likely in my mind because he was out seeking, you know, force wielders and stuff. And just because he's my favorite Star Wars character. So I was super, super hoping it would be Luke. So I just about lost my mind.
Bob? Who did you think it might have been?
Well, no, I was hoping Luke. But I'm like, it's got to be Luke. It's got to be Luke. But would it be Luke? You know, I thought, like I say, like the post-credit scene would be him showing up and taking Grogu. I didn't think there'd be like a whole scene of him just wiping out this whole gaggle of dark troopers and, you know, right, saving the day and coming in and pulling off his hood and talking and everything else. It was definitely not expected.
It was amazing.
I didn't think it would be Luke because this is a TV show. Yes, it's a very popular TV show. But the last time we saw Luke Skywalker in a TV show, it was a Christmas special. you know, the amount of money that they would have to put into, you know, like the Grand Moff Tarkin in Rogue One, Carrie Fisher in Rogue One. And I just thought, you know, just financially and just, you know, it's Mark freaking Hamill. Why would he reprise, you know, that? And that's why I thought it'd be Ezra, maybe Ahsoka.
I mean, this moment for Luke was analogous to the moment for Vader in Rogue One, where you see Luke at full power, right, as a Jedi. You know, this is, and I think in some ways for a lot of people, myself included, I think it sort of redeems our last image of him, which, you know, in Last Jedi, you know, he's a guy who's lost hope. And I, for some of us, that kind of was not the Luke we wanted to see. So now we get to see Luke, young and in his prime and still hopeful, still, you know, out there doing the good work.
With the power.
For me, it was so sad. What's that, Bob?
With the power.
Mm-hmm. With the power. To me, it was so sad because that's not the Luke that we're going to see exit this. Well, anyway, I won't.
Well, his temple hasn't been, you know.
Right.
he hasn't gone through all the dark things that basically made him give up.
Right. Right. It was. And look, I still didn't think it was Luke. I thought they're teasing us with the dark cloak. And then when you saw the right gloved hand and the green lightsaber, and I was like, oh, my God, they did it. They actually did it. And jumped off the bed. I mean, I was just like yelling almost top of my lungs, like, yahoo! And one of the things that I kind of regret as a fan that we never saw Luke in his prime, other than fighting Vader, you know, on the Death Star and trying to fight the Emperor, we never saw a fully fledged kick-ass Jedi Luke Skywalker. And we did in this episode.
Well, you know, it's funny because I didn't like wait that long. It was like all of a sudden you see the X-Wing flying in and Michael was there and he's like, I see R2 like in the X-Wing or in the X-Wing as it's flying in. He sees R2 in there. And then, yeah, he's like, I saw the hilt. I saw the hilt on the sword. You know, it's, like, it's Luke. But yeah, then yeah, as soon as the green saber came out and the way he was fighting and using the force and everything, I thought, okay, that's got to be him.
Yep. Right.
Yep.
Yeah, I was kind of like looking forward to him arriving on the bridge and seeing Boba Fett standing there.
That might not have worked out too well.
Yeah. Well, and there was Grogu touching the monitor, you know, with his hand, like, Jedi, you know, by no means do I have enough midichlorians to have force power to read Grogu's mind through the TV screen, but just that moment, it was, you know, it started the welling up in me, like.
Well, you know what I'm really wondering, yeah, you know, because they had the whole thing between, you know, Mando and Luke, and you know, Grogu holding on to Mando and all that. Which I'm sure Larry will get into in a moment. But but it was when R2 came in.
Yeah.
And then, you know, he like walked up to, so it's like, you know, is there some connection, you know?
Yeah.
When he had his training, was R2 around or, you know?
I wondered that too, Bob, because it almost seemed like R2 recognized him because he shook and he was really excited. And I didn't know, did he recognize him or did he just realize, oh, he's like Yoda? So I wondered about that.
Bob, you're going to need to bleep me out because I never considered that. Holy fucking my God. You know, oh, Jesus, that is my God.
Watch it again. Yeah. I mean, there's definitely some kind of recognition between the two.
Yeah. Yeah. Archie looks at him and he bends over and he shakes and Grogu kind of looks at him and jabbers a little bit.
I was just thinking, he's like, oh, what a cute droid. Yeah. I was so emotionally spent at that point.
You probably couldn't see clearly with all the tears and everything.
Yeah. See, now one thing I want to bring up, which I brought up before the show, was if any listeners remember our first Mandalorian episode. And we were talking about Mando one day maybe taking off his helmet. And Larry went into a whole thing about, oh, he's going to take off his helmet and the baby's going to like reach out and touch his face. And then Larry said he was going to start blubbering the man tears. Well, it happened. He predicted that exact scene. So walk us through it, Mr. Kakos.
I'm going to do the best I can. But, you know, he's when Luke says he's waiting for your permission.
Uh-oh.
Oh, we lost him.
He's verklempt. Yeah, the whole thing was pretty tough there, buddy. And, you know, and what really touched me was he told Grogu, don't be afraid. You know, and then he took off his helmet for him. You want us to keep talking? But, you know, Pedro Pascal did such a good job with that, you know, and when the baby touched him, he had this little thing where he kind of closed his eyes and he kind of like shook a little bit because you realize he's probably never been touched. His face has never been touched since he was a kid. It was so deeply emotional.
Well, and the big fake out too was there was a story that was circulating that Pedro Pascal said this was going to be his last season because there was no part of the season where he would take his helmet off.
Yeah.
And, you know, when he took it off in the episode of Mayfield, I thought, okay, that's maybe service to Pedro Pascal to keep him on. They gave him a little, gave him a little scene without the helmet. But then this part came along. And yeah, he takes it off to say his goodbye.
Yeah. And when the kid touches the helmet first, and then he takes the helmet off.
I know.
That's
it was, like I said, it was a four hanky episode for me too, buddy.
See, you know those videos that kids take where they're like watching a trailer or whatever?
Reaction.
We needed to make one of those of Larry watching the episode for the first time in that scene.
Well, and it was so good too because, you know, Mando is struggling and he looks at Luke and yeah, there was a little uncanny valley thing going with Luke. They did a good job, but you know, it was not 100%, but I'll take it. And he's just looking at this guy thinking like, you better take good care of him, you know, but he's trying so hard to keep it together for the kid. Cause everybody's had that thing where you've had, whether it's a kid, a person, a dog, whatever, and you have to hand them over to somebody and you've got to be strong. You don't want them to see that you're falling apart. Yeah. So you got to be strong and say, okay, go. And it's like, go. And then you, as soon as they're gone, it's like, oh, you know?
Yeah, but I mean, Luke realized that because he told him flat out, I'll lay down my life for him.
Yep, he did.
Or lay down my life to protect him.
Yep.
That's true.
Oh, it was good. So good.
So one thing Lieutenant Debbie was worried about.
Yeah.
Was we all know what's happening with Luke and his temple and his students.
Yeah.
And I just said, well, you know, he may graduate before then. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, it's a good question. Who knows what will happen with Grogu? And I think a lot of people are saying, well, if he's not going to be in the next season, I might not be watching because some people are really into Baby Yoda. So,
well, what I was thinking about for the next season, and I have no insider knowledge whatsoever, but it may be like a dual thing. Where they're following Mando and the whole, you know, saving of Mandalore. And then also cut back and forth showing Grogu going through his training with Luke.
That would be interesting.
I mean, yeah, you know, they've got Luke down now. They've got him in the computer program.
Yeah, they could do that.
And, you know, as far as the temple and that goes, I mean, they may have to, you know, have a story that goes through that shows it how he avoids that whole temple slaughter, you know, that
right.
And maybe he goes back to Mando before all that happens.
So if
go ahead, Walker.
I was just going to say, if Grogu is training with Luke, does that mean that Luke gets to ride on Grogu's shoulders?
Awkward. I'm wondering at what age will Grogu be able to talk to people? So can he send a hologram to Mando saying, oh, guess what? I lifted rocks today. And, you know, it was really cool. I can force jump now.
Yeah, I got to say, these Yoda creatures at 50 years old, they still can't talk. Something's not right.
When he talks, will it be like, talk can I now? Happy be I. You?
Well, you have to figure Luke's probably the one who's going to have to teach him how to talk. So,
I'm hoping it's not going to be Howie Mandel voicing Grogu with his Bob voice.
Yeah, I mean, who knows? I mean,
so
and then again, the Yoda Force Ghost is still around too, right?
Oh,
so he'll have a say in things.
My son is he busy with Yaddle, did I guess?
But see, my other question I was talking with Debbie about last night, Grogu's 50, right?
Yes.
And we're only 5 years removed from Return of the Jedi?
Yeah.
And he was being trained in temples and things, and maybe he knew R2. Who knows?
Maybe.
Did he cross paths with Yoda at some point?
Well, if he was in the Jedi Temple, they said he was saved during Order 66, right? So I think there's a good chance he did.
It's going to be exciting.
To find out. It will be very exciting.
See, that's why I think there's no way that he cannot be in the next season, because there's so many questions and so much, not just with where is he going to go, how is he going to do, but the whole background that they hinted at. Who knows?
We'll see.
Well, and just from a commercial point of view, I think it would be crazy for them not to keep him around.
Well, there was a... we'll see. I mean, you're right. He's just one of the most popular, at least marketing-wise.
Yeah.
It is called The Mandalorian. It's not the Baby Yoda show.
Yeah. Yet.
This was just the Grogu arc, the first two seasons.
Well, there was this title reveal for a series that's coming out on Disney Plus in 2021 called Grogu and the Knights of Ren. So I don't know.
Hey, that's Star Wars, as likely as Grogu. Anything else.
Everybody's getting their own show. He might too.
Well, and that's the, what about the end credits reveal?
The Book of Boba Fett.
God, yeah. That was just so perfect. I mean, there's Bib Fortuna. And you know, I had my cousin texting Jasmine last night. Who's that? Who's, you know, and Jasmine's like, pass the phone to me so I could fill in everything. Well, that's a, you know, major domo for Jabba the Hutt. And, oh, man. It's a good time to be a fan of Star Wars.
It was hilarious too, because he just doesn't even try to talk to him. He just shoots him.
Not at all. Could give a two about Fortuna.
I think a lot of people were concerned, like, well, they're trying to make Boba Fett into a hero, you know? Yeah. And I think that kind of allays any of those fears. At best, he's an anti-hero.
He's an anti-hero. There is honor, but also there's a man trying to make his way through the galaxy. So
so now the other question, though, so is Mando going off in that light cruiser, and that's going to be the next season? With him and Bo-Katan and the rest of them, you know, cruising around space trying to resurrect Mandalore, or what?
That's the thing. Does he go back to that planet with that farmer and her daughter and retire, you know, to a happy life?
He's going to have to resolve this situation with Bo-Katan and the Darksaber, I think.
That's true.
Well, next season he'll be trying to resurrect Mandalore, and the whole time she'll be trying to, like, ambush him, sort of like in the Pink Panther. Yeah, it's like he'll come walking into a room and suddenly she'll jump him and try to defeat him.
Instead of Keta, it's going to be Katan.
So, man, we're running up on a couple hours here. This was a pretty good one.
My goodness.
This was a good one. I'll tell you what, it's that part of the show where we're going to get into our sensor sweep. And Chief Engineer Bob, take it away.
Well, you know, I had something kind of cool for the sensor sweep. Maybe I'll save it for next episode, because this is our holiday episode. So maybe for the sensor sweep, we should dispense with some season's greetings.
Okay. We can do that. So on that note, Walker, you want to start us off with the greetings of seasons, as Yoda would say?
Seasons of greeting, I will. Well, you know, I'm sure everybody out there listening has, we've all gone through a pretty rough year, but I hope that whatever you celebrate at the end of the year, whether it's, you know, Hanukkah, Christmas, Festivus, Saturnalia, whatever you celebrate, I hope you're celebrating something. I hope you're doing it safely, and I hope you're healthy, wealthy, and wise, or at least one or two of those. You know, we've had a blast doing episodes this year. I think at least podcasting has been a great outlet for us during these troubled times, being able to get together and hang out and talk about the stuff we love, and hopefully listening to it has given you a little pleasure. And thanks for hanging in there with us. Thanks for listening. Hope you have a nice holiday season, and we will see you in the new year. Hang in there. I think it's going to be a better year. It certainly couldn't get any worse. So hope you have a good year next year, guys.
Thank you, Walker. Bob.
Yeah, it's been definitely a rough year for everyone. And, you know, we didn't have Dr. McCoy to come up with a vaccine like within an hour. So I guess we have the vaccines coming in the next few months. And hopefully at that point we can get back to life, whatever post-pandemic is going to be like. Hopefully we're back at conventions and shows and movies and all the fun things that we usually talk about on this thing. Let's hope that we have some cheer coming up and find as much cheer as you can, you know, over the holiday season.
Yes, indeed. Now I want to echo my podcast mates' words and sentiments, wishing you all a happy holiday. Be safe, take care of each other, be tolerant, love one another, and keep everyone in good thoughts.
Indeed.
Keep them all in your thoughts and 6 feet away.
On that note, this will conclude this transmission from Planet 8. We would like to thank all of our intergalactic audience for listening. Be sure to head on over to our website at www.planet8podcast.com, where you can get more information on this episode's topic.
For more conversation, find us on Twitter at Planet8Cast.
Or on Facebook at facebook.com/Planet8Podcast.
We want to thank you guys for tuning in each and every episode. We look forward to your input and opinions. Until next time, this is Planet 8 signing off. End transmission.
By George, he's got it. It is the end.
As it should always be. The foundlings are the future. This is the way.
This is the way. This is the way.